أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين، آمين. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا، ثبت على الحق أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا. ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا. ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به، واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا، أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. آمين آمين آمين. Oh Allah, we ask you guidance, we ask you assistance, we ask you to help us to come close together. قل لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. We ask you rahmah, we ask you maghfirah, we ask you to forgive our sins, and we ask you maghfirah and rahmah for all the Muslims who left this life, and we ask you recovery and shifa for all the Muslims who are sick. We ask you assistance for all the brothers and sisters who are Muslims around the world and they are under some kind of oppression. We ask you to make our life good inshallah bi-idhnillah, and inshallah our afterlife is good bi-idhnillah with the companionship of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ameen, ameen, ameen. So inshallah bi-idhnillah, tonight we are going to speak about something that it is just a little bit high, but not echo. But from the one that's the last one on the, yeah, this one. But the other one just, yes. So alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen. Inshallah, bidhillah. Tonight we are going to speak about one of the questions that we will be asking inshallah bi-idhnillah ta'ala. When we leave this life, we will be asking three questions in the grave. Who knows these three questions? Three questions we will be asked when we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who knows them? The first one is, who is your Lord? Man Rabbuk. The second one,
who is your Prophet?
Man Nabiyuk. The third one, what is your religion? مَا دِينُكَ. So inshallah bin Allah, tonight we are going to focus on one of these questions, which is, who is your Prophet? Who is your Prophet? Who is our Prophet? Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do we know him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? This is the question. We just know him, his name, or do we know more about him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? If we want to follow him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then we have to know more and more about him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if you ask us nowadays, can you name 3-4 grandparents of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, many Muslims may not know. So if you say, give me the name of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his father, his grandfather, his grandfather and great grandfather, like 5 names starting with Muhammad, so many Muslims may not know his name sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So for our children, our youth, we used to memorize the name of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from his name to his grandfather number 20, Adnan, which is related to Sayyidina Ismail, the son of Ibrahim alayhi wa sallam. So to know Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, first you have to know his name sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So why we should know about him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Because as we know, if we don't know him, we cannot follow him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you know someone, then you can listen to him or her and you can follow him or her. But if you don't know anything about him or her, you cannot follow him or her, because they may be wrong. They may be leading you to somewhere that you don't like. So Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we know that he is the guide for us to Jannah and Maghfirah and Rahmah, yet we have to know about his personal life sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. all the details that we can get about him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we should study his seerah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Especially nowadays, we are in the month of Rabi' al-Awwal. The month of Rabi' al-Awwal is the month when he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born. Do you know which day that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born on? Which day? Monday. Monday. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to the authentic narrations, he was born on a Monday, and he himself said in an authentic hadith, I was born on a Monday. And when he was asked about fasting Monday, he said, it is a day that I was born on, and a day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me the risala on. So Monday was a day when he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born. And the year of his birth, what do they call it? The year of?
The year of the elephant.
So why do we call it the year of the elephant? Kids, wake up. We are going to give you pizza and everything, okay? But just wake up. Huh? The year of the elephant. Why? Abraha, there was a king called Abraha in Yemen. At that time, he came to the Kaaba and he wanted to destroy the Kaaba. Why? Very good, very good, very good. Abraha was a king and he built a church in Yemen, Al-Qulais, and he beautifies that church, but nobody goes there. So he was very mad. He said, why people go to Kaaba and they don't come to my church? And then later he decided to destroy the Kaaba, and he had about 9 elephants in his army, and he was on the top of one of the elephants going to destroy the Kaaba. During that year, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved the Kaaba from Abraha and his army. That year, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born. So the day was Monday, and the month was Rabi' al-Awwal, and the year was the year of the elephant. And his name sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we said, we just at least have to memorize like few names. Muhammad, his father is Abdullah, his grandfather is Abdul Muttalib, mashallah Ali. Very good. Abdul Muttalib, his great grandfather is Hashim. What is Hashim? He didn't come tonight? Okay. So Hashim is number 4, and number 5 is Abdu Manaf. At least, just remember these 5. Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib ibn Hashim ibn Abdu Manaf. Just 5 names of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As I told you, when I was in your age, we used to memorize until Adnan. Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib ibn Hashim Abdu Manaf, and then ibn Qusay ibn Kilab ibn Murrah ibn Ka'b ibn Al-Ay ابن غالب ابن فه ابن مالك ابن النضر ابن كنانة ابن خزيمة ابن مدركة ابن إلياس ابن مضر ابن نزار ابن نزار ابن عدنان. And we have to give this to our teacher. And if we don't, they are gonna discipline us. So we have to remember the name of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Forget your name, but don't forget the name of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay, because he is going to intercede for you and help you in the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. And he is helping us here in this dunya before Yawm al-Qiyamah, so we have to know his name. Okay, so everyone knows who is Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If somebody asks you in the school, says, who is your prophet? At least you say he is Muhammad, his name is Muhammad, his father's name is Abdullah, his grandfather's name is Abdul Muttalib. At least for the junior ones in the kindergarten and elementary, these 3 names. Okay? And then he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had other names, like nicknames. Do you know any of them? Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has other names other than Muhammad. Mustafa? Huh? Mustafa is a description, okay? But the name that he named himself, and he said, this is my name. Ahmed is one of them, okay? So he is Muhammad and he is Ahmed.
Huh? Taha also, they say it's a name, but the authentic names that, he sometimes said, I am so-and-so, I am so-and-so, in the hadith, Sayyidina Jubair ibn Mut'am radiallahu anhu said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Inna li asma'a, I have some names. Ana Muhammad, I am Muhammad. Wa ana Ahmad, I am Ahmad. Wa ana al-mahi alladhi yamhu Allah bihi al-kufr. I am the eraser. With him, Allah will erase the kufr. So al-mahi, mahi is a name of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It means the eraser, because he is going to erase the kufr. I am al-mahi. أنا الحاشر الذي يحشر الناس على قدمي. حاشر means the one who gets people together, because he is the last of the prophets, and people, the يوم القيامة will come shortly after him صلى الله عليه وسلم. الحاشر, the gatherer, the one who gathers people. So it is a name of سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. وأنا العاقب الذي ليس بعده أحد. I am the last. After him is no one coming from the prophets and the messengers. So these are few names of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So first he is Muhammad, Ahmad, Mahi, very good. Somebody's awake.
Al-Hashir.
Yes, very good, mashallah Ali. You are following up. So we have these, Al-Aqib, Al-Hashir, Al-Mahi, Muhammad and Ahmed. Five nicknames. So we know his name, Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib ibn Hashim ibn Abdul Manaf, five. And other nicknames, Muhammad, Ahmed, and then Al-Mahi, Al-Hashir, Al-Aqib. Okay. The lineage of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The ulama agreed, all the biographers, those who write the biography of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even from non-Muslims, they agreed that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has the most noble and clean lineage sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His lineage is the most honorable and clean. Means, in his lineage, there is no one who has committed fahisha. There is no dirtiness or something that's not clean in his lineage sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even his fathers and grandfathers, they were not on Islam, but they did not do anything wrong. So this is the miracle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he chooses his prophets and messengers subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yajtabi min al-malaikati rusulan wa min al-nas. He chooses from the angels and from the humans. Allahu a'lamu haythu yaj'alu risalata. Allah knows where he puts his message. So all the ulama, all the scholars agreed, Muslims and non-Muslims, that the lineage of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the cleanest and the most honorable one. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came from Abdullah. Abdullah is the son of Abdul Muttalib, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about himself in a sahih hadith. Al-hadith is in Al-Bukhari. In Allah Azza wa Jalla astafa min waladi Ibrahim Ismail. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen from the children of Ibrahim Ismail. We know Ismail is the son of Ibrahim, the one that Ismail was going to sacrifice. You remember the story of Eid al-Adha? So Allah has chosen Ibrahim alayhi salam. And then from Ibrahim, Allah has chosen Ismail alayhi salam. وَاصْطَفَى مِنْ وَلَدِ إِسْمَاعِيلَ كِنَانَةَ. And Allah has chosen from Ismail the tribe of Kinana. It is a very famous tribe in Arabia. وَاصْطَفَى مِنْ بَنِي كِنَانَةَ قُرَيْشًا. And Allah has chosen from Kinana one tribe, Quraysh. وَاصْطَفَى مِنْ قُرَيْشٍ بَنِي هَاشِمٍ. And Allah has chosen from Quraysh the family of Hashim. وَاصْطَفَانِي مِنْ بَنِي هَاشِمٍ. And Allah has chosen from Banu Hashim me, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So look at this. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes from the most noble lineage that you can ever see. Sayyidina Ibrahim, Sayyidina Ismail, and then from Ismail, a tribe called Kinana. From Kinana comes Quraysh. From Quraysh comes Hashim, Banu Hashim. And then from Banu Hashim comes Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then, وَحِينَمَا سُئِلَ هِرَقْلٍ. أو سأل هرقل أبا سفيان. أبو سفيان was a Sahabi and he was going to Heracles. He was one of the kings of Persia. And then he was asking Abu Sufyan about Muhammad, where did you get this prophet? Where is he from? Abu Sufyan said, قال هو فينا ذو نسب. He is one of the most noble lineages in Mecca. فقال هرقل, Heracles said, كذلك الرسل تبعث في نسب قومها. The messengers, they come from the best lineage of their people. So even the people who are not Muslims, they knew about him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he comes from the most honorable family, from the most clean lineage sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then how was he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam born? Okay, everyone here, we have been teaching Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his seerah. And we said, do you know when he was born sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where his father was? His father was there? No. His father passed away before his birth. So when Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born, he was born as an orphan. As an orphan. That's why he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in an authentic narration, I am going to be with the guardian of the orphan like this in Jannah. And he pointed these two fingers. Anyone takes care of the orphan, I will be with him like these two in Jannah. He was an orphan, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when he was born, his father died before this. And then, as we said, the ulama agreed the month is Rabi'ul Awwal. Some of them say that he was born on the 2nd of Rabi', or 8th of Rabi', or 10th of Rabi', or 12th of Rabi'. But the most authentic narration, they say it was 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal. And this is what Ibn Kathir radiallahu anhu rahimahullah said. It was the authentic one that he was born on the year of the elephant and on the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal. And then the ulama of Sirah said, before he was born sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when his mother got pregnant with him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she was talking about it. Amina, his mother, she didn't find any pain during the pregnancy. Usually, when a woman gets pregnant, she gets some pain. And she gets pregnant about 7 or 9 months. So the more the child gets bigger, the more the troubles come. And the movement, and all these things. And nowadays we can see our women, they go to the physicians and they take medicine and all these things. Amina, the mother of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she said, I have never found any heaviness or any pain when I was pregnant in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَلَمَّا ظَهَرَ خَرَجَ مَعَهُ نُورٌ أَضَاءَ مَا بَيْنَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ. And she said, when I was giving birth to him, I have seen a light that's coming out from me that is making between the east and west is lighting up. And this is the light of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is a sign that he is going to guide everyone in this universe sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is his mother talking about her experience when she was pregnant in him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وفي حديث العرباني بن ساني رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إني عند الله في أم الكتاب لخاتم النبيين. The prophet says, I am with Allah سبحانه وتعالى the last of the prophets. وإن آدم لمجندل في طينته. Adam was still there in front of Jannah waiting for Allah to blow in him before he becomes alive. Allah سبحانه وتعالى has decreed that I am the last of the prophets. This is Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying it. وَسَأُنَبِّيكُمْ بِتَأْوِيلِ ذَلِكَ دَعْوَةُ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. I am dua of my father Ibrahim. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send a messenger from the people of Mecca. When Ibrahim took Ismail and he went with Ismail and Hajar too. Where did Ibrahim go? Ibrahim. He took Ismail, the young boy, with his mother, and they went to?
The desert.
They went to what?
The desert. A desert.
What is the name of this desert? It becomes later, it becomes what?
Mecca.
Mecca. The city of?
Mecca.
Mecca. Guys, you didn't study good. You may get C tonight. We have to get an A plus Ameen, okay? So Sayyidina Ibrahim took Ismail alayhi salam and Hazar, and he put them in a desert, which becomes later Mecca. And then he said, رَبَّنَا وَابْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ. After he talked to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he said, oh Allah, I left my son and my wife in a desert place. بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرْعٍ عِنْدَ بَيْتِكَ الْمُحَرَّمِ, close from the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ فَاجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِّنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ. Oh Allah, make them among those who establish the salah, and the people come to them. And then he said later, رَبَّنَا وَابْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. Oh my Lord, send to these people, the people of Mecca, a messenger from them to guide them and to purify them. And this messenger was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if somebody asks you and says, who is the dua of Ibrahim, da'wah of Ibrahim? He is Muhammad. Sayyidina Ibrahim make the dua that a messenger comes in Mecca, and this messenger becomes Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he says, I am da'wah to Ibrahim. I am the dua of my father Ibrahim. وَبِشَارَةُ عِيسَى قَوْمَهُ. And I am the glad news that Isa gave to his people. وَإِذْ قَالَ عِيسَى, وَإِذْ قَالَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيَّ مِنَ التَّوْرَاةِ وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِي إِسْمُهُ أَحْمَد. So Isa said to his people, the children of Israel, yeah, oh children of Israel, I am a messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you, and I am coming with the Injil that is going with the Torah that came before me, and I am giving you the glad news of a messenger who comes after me. His name is Ahmad. And this is in the Torah and Injil. In the Bible, this also is there. It is written, the name of Sayyidina Muhammad is written in the Torah and the Injil, the Gospel and the Bible, that he is coming after Isa. So he is the dua of Ibrahim. He is the glad news of Isa. وَرُؤْيَا أُمِّ الَّتِي رَأَتْ أَنَّهُ خَرَجَ مِنْهَا نُورٌ أَضَاءَتْ لَهُ قُصُورَ الشَّامِ. And I am the dream, the vision of my mother, who has seen a vision when she was pregnant in me, that a light came out from her, and it made all the palaces of Syria lighting up. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is explaining to us what happened to his mother when she was pregnant with him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is the miracle of his, even before he was born sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was a miracle sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we have to know these specifics about him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then after he comes sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to this life, as we know also from authentic narrations, when he comes out from his mother's womb, he comes out sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the ground, and he is holding his fingers, but he is pointing with this one, meaning la ilaha illallah, and he was in a prostration mood, like in sujood mood sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came out to this world sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who was the lady, the first lady that Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started to be breastfed from her? The first foster mother for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yes, Ali. Amina is his mother. And the tradition of that time, that the mother, when she gets birth, she gives the baby to someone else to breastfeed and take the baby away so he can grow well. Huh? Who is the first one? It's not Amina. Someone else. Halima, no. There was one before Halima. One lady before Halima, and she was fostering Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I will give you a clue. She is the lady, when she went to Abu Lahab, and she told him, Abu Lahab, Amina got a baby, and he's a boy. And Abdul Muttalib named him Muhammad. And Abu Lahab, what did he do? He told her, you are free. He was very happy that Amina got a baby, and they called him Muhammad, and then he set his servant or his slave free. He told her, you are free. She's the one, the first one to foster him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What's the name? Ummu Jamil is the wife of Abu Lahab. This one was the servant of Abu Lahab. Her name is Thuwaybah. Thuwaybah. The first lady that Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started taking her milk is Thuwaybah, the servant of Abu Lahab. And after this was Halima Sa'diya radiallahu anha. How many years did he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spend with Halima? Yawasif. Close. Ali.
15.
Less than this. Five. Less than this.
Four.
Four years.
4 years.
Good job, Ali. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spent 4 years with Halima radiallahu anha. During these 4 years, she said, I have seen many blessings in my life because of that baby, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we know that she was hesitant to take him first when she went to Mecca. Why she was hesitant? She was looking for
a rich family.
Why?
Because his father's dead, so like they won't pay her
She doesn't get lots of money if she goes with an orphan child. She's looking for like a big family because they give more money. And she is a poor lady and she's looking for money. So she didn't find any baby in Mecca at that time except him. Why? There was a reason.
When she was coming
from Banu Sa'd, the women, they come in a group. The women who take the babies to foster them, they come in a group. She was coming with them, but she had what?
The animal that she was riding.
The donkey that she was riding has a limb. Was one of the legs of the donkey was like injured. So the donkey was slow. So she missed the group. So the group of women, they came to Mecca before her and they took the rich babies. And then this is the only one who is left is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She refused to take him first, but then she talked to her husband and she said, let's take him and maybe there is a blessing in this child. And then once she took him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all her life turned upside down from bad to good. She has seen all things, all miracles of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Once she started breastfeeding him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she didn't even have lots of milk because she doesn't have food to eat. But once he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam starts taking her milk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses her, and she's getting more milk for him and for his foster brother, Abdullah. So this is the first insight, the first miracle that happened to Halima Sa'diya. And before this, once she carried him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and she mounted her donkey, what happened? The donkey is okay.
She was the first one.
Yes, the donkey, maybe she made it back before those ladies who came before her. And they were asking her, what's going on, Halima? You are, the donkey is very fast and it was injured. She said, this is the baby that I got from Mecca, and I believe that he is a blessed baby. That's why we are getting this. So Halima Sa'diya radiallahu anha, she was blessed to foster him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for 4 years. During these 4 years, a big incident happened. That's why she returned him to his mother. And what was the incident that happened?
Two men came and they opened his chest and they got the Zimzam.
Yes. His brother came running to his father and mother one day, and he said, my mom and dad, something is going on. Something is happening to my brother. They said, what is going on? He said, I saw two men. They came and they opened his chest. and they get his heart out. So Halima and her husband, they ran. And then they found Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam coming back, and he's very yellow and he looks very tired. And then when they look at his chest sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they found as if his chest was opened and there's a mark over there. And this was Jibreel alayhi salam and the angels, and they opened his chest sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at 4 years of age, and they took his heart out and they cleaned it with Zamzam water. And they took the hadhu shaitan, or whatever shaitan will have in his heart, out. And whatever enmity or hatred or bad things will be in the heart, out. And they cleansed the heart and they put it back. And then Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam runs. And then Halima was worried. And then she decided to return him back sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his mother. And she went to Amina and she wanted to return him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Amina. And then Amina said, why? Last time you came here, you wanted to keep him long. You don't want to give him back to me. And now you are getting him back. There has to be a secret. There has to be a reason. And Halima didn't want to tell Amina, but finally she told her that this happened to him. And I am scared that something will happen to him and it will be my responsibility. So Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes back to his mother, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accompanies his mother when he was 6 years to visit his grandparents in a place called Al Abwa, and it is between Mecca and Medina. And then when he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was there with his mother, she got sick and she passed away when he was 6 years old. Still a boy, 6 years old, and we have been talking about these 6 years for half an hour. 6 years old, has no mother, has no father, his chest was just open, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is still 6 years old. Then who took care of him next? His grandfather, Abdul Muttalib. Abdul Muttalib, after his mother dies, so Abdul Muttalib takes a full guardianship of his grandchild Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then just to remind ourselves, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he grow up and he becomes a messenger and he goes to Mecca and then to Medina, and then he was coming back to Mecca in the 8th year of Hijrah, he passed by the place where his mother died. And he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to go and visit her grave. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him the permission to go and visit. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to visit his mother. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the sahaba ridwanullah alayhim, visit the graves, it will remind you of death. And he started crying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, remembering his mother. And he just lived with her maybe 2 years. He didn't even spend the 6 years with his mother. But the mother is the mother. She is the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed you with. She is the one that takes care of you. She is the one who stays up late every night when you are sick for you to feel good. And she is the one who is always helping you and pushing you to be good. And how many women that we have seen in our lives that they produced great scholars and great messengers. We just take for example Al-Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah wa radiyallahu anhu. Al-Imam Shafi'i, he comes from the same tribe of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is connected, he comes from Quraysh. And his father died when he was young, and his mother took care of him, and she was trying to do some business, and she sent him to the madrasa to learn the Quran and to learn the fiqh. And later he becomes one of the four imams, rahimahullah wa radiyallahu anhu. And this is a woman. So your mother is the first one that you should take care of. So never make her upset. Always she is looking for you to be the best. So never let her down. So this is Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is crying when he remembers his mother. And at that time, he was about like almost 60 years old. This is the 8th year of Hijrah, and he died on the 11th. So he was exactly 60 years old. 60 years. And he's crying for just 2 years that he lived with his mothers. How many years did we live with our mothers? A lot. What did we do? Almost nothing. We are going to do this and notice when we lose them. When you lose your mother, you will know what a big loss that you have. But once you have your mom, you think it is guaranteed. Every day you wake up in the morning, she is giving you something to eat. She is preparing everything for you for the school. She is taking you to some places when your dad is busy. And then you start being grumpy and you don't like what she's doing. And when you come to the teenage, the first one that you try to be against is your mom. Say, yeah, I'm not listening to anyone. I am a big man now. I don't need anyone to tell me anything. Yes? This is what we do sometimes. Sometimes. So look at Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was remembering and reminding himself of his mother, and he started crying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is just his mother. He was passing by the grave and he started to cry, and he told the Sahaba, you visit the graves because it will remind you of maut. And then after he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw his mother dying in front of him. Then who took care of him next? Look, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is moving from a house to a house, from a guardianship to a guardianship, from someone to someone else. And he is still 6 years old, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at this. This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us. This is the life of the best man that Allah has ever created. So no one will never have such a difficult life like him. So you never say, I have a difficult life. Your life, whatever you have, it will be good. And you say, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Always say, Alhamdulillah. So after Amina died, then he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went under the guardianship of his grandfather Abdul Muttalib. But there is another woman who comes into the life of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she is very famous woman, and she becomes his nurse, Hadina, the one who is like his second mother. Do you know the name? Think.
Sarah?
No.
Maria?
Ummu Ayman. Ummu Ayman. Her name is Baraka. And her nickname is Ummu Ayman. Ummu Ayman, she was a servant to his father. You know Abdullah, the father of Sayyidina Muhammad? So Sayyidina Muhammad inherits her because she, servants at that time, if I die and I leave a servant, my kids will take that servant. He or she will serve them. So she was a servant to Abdullah, the father of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes back after his mother is dead, then she takes care of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Gadduhu Abdul Muttalib, he made sure that she takes care of him. And then when he becomes 8 years old, another big incident happens, which is his grandfather Abdul Muttalib passes away and dies too. And then he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again moves to another house, which is the house of his uncle Abu Talib. His uncle Abu Talib is the one that he stayed with long time, and he provided protection and love and help. And Abu Talib's wife, Fatima bint Asad, the mother of Ali and Ja'far, she was to Sayyidina Muhammad as his mother. And this is what he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about Fatima: she is my mother after my mother. Abu Talib's wife, she was taking care of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as if he is her own child sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Talib was not that rich. He was trying to be a businessman, but he wasn't that rich. And he has lots of kids. And then when they come to eat, they push Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam first to start eating. Why? Because they knew that Muhammad is a blessed boy. Wherever he goes, the blessings are there. So before they start eating, they push him to start first. And once he starts sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Talib gets his children around the food, and they eat and they finish, and the food is the same. Look at this barakah, the blessings that surrounds him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wherever he goes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is blessing him and blessing anyone who is helping him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as we know, Abu Talib always supported him. And when he was about to give up on him, when the disbelievers came to him and said, Abu Talib, your nephew Muhammad, he's giving us hard time. He is making fun of our gods. If he needs money, we are going to give him money. If he needs influence and power, we will make him the leader of Mecca, the president of Mecca. If he needs to marry someone, we'll get him the most beautiful woman from the best family. But just let him go away from our idols, our gods. And then Abu Talib speaking to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this famous story, famous conversation, which is very influential conversation. For this, Abu Talib got his punishment in the fire is less than anyone else. Because of that, he never gave up on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he tells him, my nephew, they are telling me, just you say whatever you say, you do whatever you do, but stay away from their gods. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says his famous statement, by Allah, my uncle, if they give me the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left hand, to leave that affair, to leave that matter, I will never leave it until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it clear, or I die on this way of Allah. And then his uncle, since that moment, told him, Muhammad, go and say whatever you want to say, do whatever you want to do, I am always backing you up, I will never leave you alone. Since that time, and Abu Talib was like his father, his uncle who cares for him. And then when he died, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very sad. And he was trying to get him to say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, before he dies. And then when he goes to see him before he passed away, comes Abu Lahab and Abu Jahl and everyone else. And they found Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sitting next to his uncle, trying to convince him and telling him, my uncle, just say, La ilaha illallah, I will take it. And I'll make sure that you will be in Jannah with me. And then he was about to say it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't write this down that Abu Talib will be a Muslim. So he didn't. And Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab, they're coming and they're saying, Abu Talib, are you going to leave the deen of your parents and grandparents for what he is saying? So Abu Talib said, I will die on the religion of my fathers. And he passed away without saying, La ilaha illallah. Muhammad Rasulullah. Yet Sayyidina Muhammad makes dua for him a lot when he passed away, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, Muhammad, stop. Staghfir lahum aw la tastaghfir lahum. In tastaghfir lahum 70 maratan lay yaghfir Allah lahum. Allah will never forgive him. If you make istighfar for him or not, Allah will never forgive him, because he died on kufr. He died without saying La ilaha illallah. And then Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah was giving him a gift, telling him, Muhammad, I will give him a little bit of adab, and this adab will be lower than anyone else, just for the sake of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is a kafir, a disbeliever, who gets a relief from the fire because he helped Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he didn't say La ilaha illallah. So what do you think of a Muslim who believes in Allah and believes in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and comes for salah and helps the needy and sometimes make mistakes and commit sins like we do, but he comes back to his Lord quite often and say, oh my Lord, forgive me. Do you think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take him by his sins? I don't think so. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ar-Rahim, al-Wadud, the most excessively loving one, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He called himself these names for us. He delayed his rahmah, 99 parts of rahmah, for us on the day of Yawm al-Qiyam. So brothers, sisters, and young ones, we should learn about Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We think that when we die and the angels come in the grave and say, who is your Lord? You would say Allah. Who is your Prophet? You would say Muhammad. What is your deen? You say Islam. You think you will do it, but you will never do it until you know what does it mean. Who is your Lord? Allah. Do you know Allah? What did you do for Allah? Who is your Prophet? Muhammad. Do you know Muhammad? Did you follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And if you did, you will automatically answer. But if you didn't, and you are the most eloquent person in this life, you can never say it at that time. So to answer the questions of the grave, you have to know our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to know his name, to know his seerah, what happened to him, and to be engaged in what happened to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So nowadays we have to learn from his seerah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to look around us, what is going on nowadays? Many things are going on, and sometimes we love him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much, but sometimes we do something against him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like what? Like things that he didn't do. Like what? Just the celebration of the mawlid that people do. And I will end with this. This is serious. We claim that we follow Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we claim that we follow him and we love him, follow him. Come for Fajr Salah every day. Then you are celebrating Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a birthday and his life. Come to Jum'ah every Jum'ah. Then you are celebrating Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a life. Come to the halaqat and the durus. Go wherever you find a majlis of ilm, of knowledge, a teacher who is teaching something good, go there and seek knowledge. Then you are celebrating Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a birth. Fast Mondays and Thursdays, because he did sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because it was a day that he was born on. Fast 13, 14, 15 of each month, then you are celebrating him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But to neglect everything, and not to come for the salah, and not to come for Jum'ah, and once when Rabi' al-Awwal comes, 12th of Rabi', the Milad al-Nabi, I gather the people and we start talking, and sometimes we do things that are against the Sunnah, and we claim that we love him. This is far away from what he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants us to do. And if he likes this, he himself should have done it. Or the Sahaba. No one loves him more Abu Bakr Siddiq and Umar and Ali and Uthman. None of them. They gather together on the Milad al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they make it a special day. No one. The Salaf after them. The four Imams, Bukhari, Muslim, and all these ulama, at that time, nobody did this. Until maybe the time of about like 600 years maybe after his death, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or more, until some people started doing this. And then it becomes a culture in many places, in many countries, that when the Rabi' al-Awwal starts, we have to get some lights and we have to say special things. We have to gather together during that night. And some people even make some kind of dancing and some kind of singing. And they say, we love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do you love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Yes. Why you dance? Why you gather people, do this? They say, we love him. We give some halwa. He doesn't need halwa. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he doesn't need halwa from us. He wants us to come for salah. And he doesn't want us to be in a situation on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, when we come there and he is trying to get us to drink from his hand, but the angels come and they push us away. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he knows his people, his ummah. He would talk to the angels saying, these are from my ummah, these are Muslims, why you push them back? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be told, you don't know Muhammad, after you passed away, they changed your sunnah. So we don't want one of these people that we will push away from the hawd, al-kawthar, drinking from his hand, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also we don't want to be from the people that Allah doesn't want to speak to. Speaking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah is an advantage. Seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah is a huge advantage. Those who do not obey Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they will never see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you remember in Surah Al-Mutaffifin, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about those people? كَلَّا إِنَّهُمْ عَنْ رَبِّهِمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ لَمَحْجُوبُونَ. They will never be seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because they didn't follow him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in dunya. So take it serious. The mawlid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rabi' al-Awwal, what do we celebrate? We celebrate him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our lives. We try to look like him, to walk like him, to talk like him. Our life to be the Quran as he did sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aisha said, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a Quran walking on the face of the earth. Are we Qurans walking? I don't think so. When we walk around, and sometimes when we get something new, we try to be arrogant. And if somebody speaks to us, you think, I'm the man, I know everything. You don't know anything. And unfortunately, even my father and my mother, if you talk to your mom and dad, sometimes you'll be like this. And then when the Mawlid comes, you want to eat halwa, and you want to sing some songs, and then I love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Loving Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is never by the songs, never by the halwa, it is by following him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, following Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it clearly in the Quran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Say, O Muhammad, to the people, if you really love Allah, then follow me. Allah will love you and forgive you your sins. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us true followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to plant the seed of Iman in our hearts. I ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us, our children and the Muslim community, to come back together to La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. I ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to bestow his mercy upon all those who are here and those who are absent. I ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to get the Muslim community together, to help each other, to cooperate, to follow Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to take dunya out of our heart and put it in our hands. I ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable all of us to build for ourselves houses and palaces in Jannah by our a'mal. اللهم اغفر لنا ما قدمنا وما أخرنا ما أسررنا وما أعلنا ما أنت أعلم به منا أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر وأنت على كل شيء قدير وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وجزاكم الله خيرا.